Hi, and welcome to Practice Update. My name is Matt Mosin. Today we're going to be talking a little bit about non-muscle invasive bladder cancer and different management strategies. So Jen, I thought it would be useful to talk a little bit about some of the alternative intravesical regimens that you use for patients that have high risk non-muscle invasive bladder cancer that receive induction BCG and then have persistent disease, so have to move on to a different therapy.
Yeah, that's a difficult problem for urologists, and there's a couple of different ways to manage that, both intravesically, and now we actually have some systemic therapies too. So for intravesical therapies, there's a variety of different chemotherapeutic agents. So gemcitabine, docetaxel, the combination of the two, mitomycin C, and valrubicin, which is actually FDA approved for that indication of being unresponsive to BCG induction. All of the different agents have sort of varying response rates. Some of the data for sequential gemcitabine docetaxel is fairly promising in that the response rates can be as high as 40% at 1 year for patients with carcinoma in situ, which is obviously a difficult problem, although the rates are still lower than we'd like them to be.
What are some of the strategies that you might use for patients that you choose to repeat a induction course of BCG, but they're having trouble tolerating it? So what are some of the strategies or adjustments you might make to the regimen?
Yeah, BCG does have a lot of side effects for patients, and things like urgency, frequency, those symptoms do affect their ability to do the medication. And we know that if they can't do the regimen according to the 6-week induction and ideally do maintenance therapy as well, if they can't complete that, their likelihood of having a complete response is lower. So we want to do everything we can to maximize their adherence to the regimen, and that can be achieved in a couple of ways. So symptomatic management with anticholinergics is often helpful for patients, provided they don't have urinary retention. And also, it's possible to reduce the dose of BCG, particularly in the maintenance setting. There's data to suggest there's similar efficacy, and that can really reduce side effects for patients and improve their adherence to the protocol.
Those are both great, commonly used. Some of the other strategies might be to space out the doses or give them, for example, a week off, occasionally giving a fluoroquinolone. And I think just ruling out a UTI or some of the basic things. But I agree with you that BCG is still sort of the cornerstone of therapy. Now that we have immunotherapy, I think it's important to consider including the medical oncologist. So moving forward, when you're seeing a bladder cancer patient with high risk disease, when will you think about involving the medical oncologist to discuss management options for those patients?
Yeah, it's really uncharted territory for us in terms of the localized non-muscle invasive bladder cancer setting. So pembrolizumab is approved for the use of BCG refractory carcinoma in situ. And it's a systemic immunotherapy given every 3 weeks and shows a fairly good response rate at a year of around 40% in the preliminary studies from the KEYNOTE study. So I think that that is a potential option for our patients going forward. It's definitely a new option, and it's a different type of protocol. So patients have to be understand that they'll be receiving systemic immunotherapy for every 3 weeks. And there's some new side effects that will be very different compared to what we're used to managing with intravesical therapy. So we'll definitely need to collaborate closely with our medical oncology colleagues to be able to safely and successfully give the medication.